Happy Pride Month! Queen's Public Library continues its ongoing commitment to promote queer liberation and representation across our borough and beyond. Whether you're looking for books and resources, engaging in inclusive programs, or just seeking a welcoming space, we are here for you. Come on by and let us know, what's your query? For more information, visit queenslib.org/pride2023. Summer reading kicks off this month. Visit summerreading.queenslibrary.org for our full summer reading program schedule, book lists for all ages, and other resources to keep your kids engaged and learning all summer long. Juneteenth celebrates the end of slavery in the United States. Check out our reading lists and join us for a wide range of programs to learn more about this important day in U.S. history. Visit our website for more information.
Welcome to Queen's Public Library's talk with Matthew Specktor, author of Always Crashing in the Same Car, about James Joyce's 1922 classic, Ulysses. From Carl Gustav Jung, what is so staggering about Ulysses is the fact that behind a thousand veils, nothing lies hidden, that it turns neither toward the mind nor toward the world, but as cold as the moon looking on from cosmic space, allows the drama of growth, being, and decay to pursue its course. From T.S. Eliot, I hold this book to be the most important expression which the present age has found. It is a book to which we are all indebted and from which none of us can escape. He went on to assert that Joyce was not at fault if people after him did not understand it. Quote, the next generation is responsible for its own soul. A man of genius is responsible to his peers, not to a studio full of uneducated and undisciplined coxcombs. from Virginia Woolf, Ulysses was a memorable catastrophe, immense in daring, terrific in disaster. From Vladimir Nabokov, a divine work of art and the greatest masterpiece of the 20th century prose. It towers above the rest of Joyce's writing, with noble originality, unique lucidity of thought and style, and finally from Zadie Smith. For me, Joyce is the ultimate realist because he is trying to convey how experience really feels, and he found it to be so idiosyncratic he needed to invent a new language for it. Hi, I'm Brian Alessandro. I have written for Interview Magazine, Newsday, Pank, Huffington Post, Lambda Literary, The Gay and Lesbian Review, and I've recently co-adapted Edmund White's A Boy's Own Story into a graphic novel for Top Shelf Productions. Additionally, I co-edited Fever Spores, The Queer Reclamation of William S. Burroughs, an anthology of essays and interviews about Burroughs for Rebel Satori Press. I'm also the co-founder and editor-in-chief of the literary journal, The New Engagement. My first novel, The Unmentionable Mon, was published in 2015 by Cairn Press. And my first feature film, Afghan Hound, was produced by Marie Media in 2011 and is now streaming on Plex, Tubi, and Amazon. My new novel, Performer Non Grata, was released this past April by Rebel Satori Press. Culture Connection, curated by Daniel Zaleski and now in its 10th year at the Queen's Public Library, is proud to present international artists from emerging talent to award-winning masters. These disciplines include music, theater, author talks, and film. Now expanding into a virtual format, Culture Connection is currently reaching a global audience. Matthew Specktor is the author of the novels American Dream Machine and That Summertime Sound, a nonfiction book, The Sting, and the forthcoming memoir, The Golden Hour. His writing has appeared in the New York Times, The Paris Review, The Believer, Tin House, Vogue, GQ, Black Clock, and Open City. He has been a McDowell Fellow and is a founding editor of the Los Angeles Review of Books. I interviewed him a year and a half ago for this very program for his outstanding memoir, literary criticism, hybrid, Always Crashing in the Same Car. Thank you so much, Matthew, for joining us, and happy Bloomsday.
You too. Thanks for having me back.
Thank you. It's my pleasure.
Yeah.
All right. So, you know, where to start, right? Ulysses is a deceptively complex novel, and yet it is a story of really only three people: Leopold Bloom, who was in search of a son or a son-like figure, his wife Molly, a singer having had an adulterous affair, and Leo's new friend, Stephen Dedalus, in search of a father or father-like figure during the course of a single day, June 16th, 1904 in Dublin, Ireland. What else is James Joyce's epic about, and wherein lies the complexity?
I'm gonna solve this by saying that, you know, I'm not a Joyce scholar and I'm not an academic. I'm a civilian reader. Just a humble
civilian reader.
Coxcomb. Coxcomb. Yeah. But I have read it multiple times, and I feel like I kind of want to invert this question a little bit to turn it around, just because so much gets made out of the complexities of the novel, mm-hmm. and to sort of train my eye upon the simplicities. Not that anything in it is exactly simple, but right. Anne Enright, I think the poet, said something like, apart from almost everything you can imagine, nothing much happens in Ulysses. And that's kind of true. I mean, it's really, the novel takes place over the span of 24 hours. It follows, both a man, Leopold Bloom, who's an advertising canvas salesman, as he kind of makes his rounds, as he wakes up and goes to the butcher and buys a kidney for his wife to fix her breakfast in bed. As he, scans a sort of dirty letter that he's had sent under a pseudonym to a P.O. box so his wife won't see it. He goes to a funeral, he's kind of doing very, very, very ordinary things. And also, Stephen Dedalus, who is a young student, who lives in Martello Tower with a couple of his friends, although I'm not sure friends is quite the right word, because they sort of rub him the wrong way. But and of course Molly, Bloom's wife, who Bloom is very well aware is spending the day at home, where she's going to meet with her lover. And part of what Bloom is up to during the day is trying to avoid the fact that he knows that that's happening and that there's nothing he can do to stop it.
The title of the book, Ulysses, which is the Latin for Odysseus, as of the Greek myth, and Homer's The Odyssey. Leopold is on an odyssey of sorts. He is Odysseus, Molly is Penelope, and then Daedalus is Telemachus, their child, right? Why do you think Joyce made the allusions to Greek myth in what was at the time modern day Ireland?
Well, he did it, he really did it, I think, to impose a sense of both scope and just of order on this kind of very teeming, because even though I just said there are three characters, and that's true, it's very populated. It's just full of tiny, tiny, tiny bits of matter and other people that these people encounter. And it's full of encounter, and it's full of material. I mean, it's really one of the most kind of like granular urban novels to exist. Anywhere. And I think even since, I don't think anything has come close to kind of being as microscopic and as particular in the way that drills into the world that it's describing. So, on the one hand, I think Joyce did it, just to sort of shape his material in a way, to impose this kind of Apollonian order on it. But I would also say, the schema for it was lurking in Joyce. I mean, certainly the kind of attachment to Greek myth was already there, I think, even before he started the novel. I mean, Stephen Dedalus, Stephen in this book, is also the protagonist of Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man.
Right.
So, and the kind of Greek myth thing is already embedded in his name. Mm-hmm. A long time ago I read Ellman's biography of Joyce, but it's been so long and I couldn't find my copy, so I couldn't quite refresh my awareness of sort of where Joyce kind of developed that attachment. But it certainly was organic to him. It wasn't there was nothing about it
it wasn't a gimmick. He wasn't doing it just for flash. Like, there was something organic
I'm gonna structure all these parallels. Right. I just found them, found them apt to the material, and then did it because he could, because he had the kind of shoulders and the ambition to sort of take these very ordinary people, because these are not heroic people, not in conventional. So certainly they're not heroic in the Greek sense. I do think that they're heroic in other senses, which I'm sure we'll come to.
Sure. But, and yeah. This idea, though, of there being like an epic quality to everybody's day, you know, right. To any average person's day, there could be an epic quality to that. And there's a flood of voices in this, yes. in this novel. And so besides just, you know, Molly, Leopold, and Stephen, they're, you know, the thousands of people who populate their day that right. they have brief encounters with, they're on their own daily epics, perhaps, you know,
yeah.
there's something profound about that.
I think that's absolutely true. And I think, you know, no one, not even, you know, people talk about Knosgard or whatever, like, you know, kind of bringing all this very quotidian experience into their fiction, but nobody did it with the kind of detail and density. Nobody ever has or will since the sort of, you know, that kind of granularity in fiction. It just hasn't happened. Mm-mm. Probably shouldn't happen.
when and how did you first read Ulysses, and what were your initial impressions?
I first read it when I was 19. It was my mom's favorite book. I was a college student. I wasn't taking a course on Ulysses or anything, but I was, you know, I knew I wanted to be a writer, and I thought, well, you know, if you want to be a writer, you should probably read Ulysses. So, you know, I grabbed hold of, this was in the pre-internet days. So I fastened on to, you know, there were and still are any number of guidebooks that you can sort of, you know, buy to sort of help unpack the sort of various schema and the layers of meaning and all that. Dennis Gilbert and Harry Blamires, I can't remember how you spell it. So, you know, I read it in the kind of very, you know, very slowly, very kind of like toggling between reading a chapter, then reading the two guides, then going back and reading it again. You know, it wasn't fun. It was work. And, you know, even though I would say that on balance, it wasn't fun, that, you know, there are just passages of such incredible beauty.
Oh, sure.
And you know, we'll get to this, but the sort of the complexities, we make so much out of, you know, the complexities of Ulysses. Oh, it's, you know, like it's Mount Everest or something. and parts of it are very hard.
Yes.
You know, and I do think that to read it at all, you have to be willing to kind of surrender yourself to the fact that there will be places, more especially in the kind of late going of the novel, where you just don't really know what the fuck is going on.
Yeah.
You know, and that this book will always be, you know, a little smarter than most of us. And that's okay. I mean, I think even back when I was 19, I read it with, you know, I was also reading a lot of Nabokov, and he has that mm-hmm. great book, Lectures on Literature, where he, you know, his own kind of undergraduate course in Ulysses is reproduced, you know, in all of his notes on it. And even he, there are kind of moments where he's like, well, you know, this part is impenetrable. You can kind of ignore it. And I figure, you know, if it's smart enough to defeat Nabokov, I'm not going to feel too bad about the fact that it makes a mess here and there.
I appreciate how honest he was about that. And I think,
you have to be, and it's, sure. you know, it's not a sin. It's not a short.
No, not at all.
Feel that way.
You know, and sometimes you just want to kind of gloss over those difficult sections just to get a sense of what he's trying to do and appreciate the style. I remember Alice Munro once said, a book is like a house. And you kind of go into it and you pass through it. And there are some rooms you want to spend a lot of time in and other rooms you want to kind of dip out of quickly. A book could be like that too. So Ulysses, which was published in 1922, the same year, we should add, as T.S. Eliot's The Wasteland, Virginia Woolf's Jacob's Room, Marcel Proust's In Search of Lost Time, and the year E.M. Forster returned to work on A Passage to India, is of course a prime example of modernism. What is literary modernism exactly for our viewers who don't know? What are its defining characteristics, and how did it change literature?
Now you do have me reaching back to my college. A shout out to Professor Clay Hubbs of
Hampton College,
who taught the modernism seminar I took. Modernism, literary modernism, was a movement that happened in the shadow of World War I, and that attempted to sort of reckon with the breach, not just of that war, but with the ideas and ruptures that were sort of contemporaneous with it, with mm-hmm. Darwin, with Nietzsche, with Freud, you know, just kind of with those kind of pillars of 20th century thought mm-hmm. that changed the way that we, you know, were supposed to understand the world and our place in it. The stream of consciousness is one of its kind of key tools, as we know, mm-hmm. right? That's one thing. Unreliable narration, right?
Mm-hmm.
And again, Wolf, Proust, the people that you mentioned are also a big part of it. But I also feel like the markers of these movements can sometimes seem a little arbitrary. Like, mm-hmm. I think, you know, there are the kind of depictions of consciousness you find in Wolf or James or Joyce are totally prefigured by what you find in Henry James, in the late mm-hmm. Henry James, especially in something like The Golden Bowl, which is definitely a pre-modernist novel. Mm-hmm. And, you know, even before that, I mean, I think sometimes I remember first reading Moby Dick and kind of getting into Melville and thinking, this is so much closer to like mid-20th century European modernism.
Yeah.
Like Kafka. Yeah. It's way yeah. closer to Kafka than it is to like
yeah.
Hawthorne, you know?
Yeah, I found that too. I found that too. And I mean, I know not going as far back, but right. D.H. Lawrence too, for sure. that matter.
Yeah.
Know?
Yeah.
Interestingly, that through most of the book, we are centered on the stories of Leopold and Stephen. It's in the final section of the book, that very complex section that you're talking about earlier, which is quite long. We are with Molly, and yes. we'll return to the section later. But for now, talk a little bit about how some scholars and readers consider this approach sort of feminist in this regard.
Yeah, I mean, I do think that there are, you know, some people who find it not so feminist. I mean, right? That's mm-hmm. that's a point sure. of debate. Sure. And I think, you know, again, I haven't delved into the scholarship around it, but I would imagine that, you know, there's a little way in which Joyce kind of frames Molly as like the, you know, the eternal feminine, right? The, mm-hmm. you know, the mother and things that feel a little, there's a little kind of like virgin whore. You could extrapolate a certain kind
it's
of
dichotomy. Like
thing
yeah.
happening there. If you wanted to, but you know, sure. I guess my own feeling about this is that, you know, Molly is a figure with tremendous agency, right? Mm-hmm. And she's not really idealized in a way. I mean, she's kind of like, you know, she's not a towering intellectual, you know, I think, right? And neither is Bloom. They're both, they're both kind of like very kind of middle-class people with middle-class tastes. But you know, she is sexually active with mm-hmm. with Boylan, the mm-hmm. promoter of her, Blazes Boylan, the promoter of her singing career.
Yes.
And she's not villainized for this. I think that's the kind of the single most kind of feminist thing about the novel is that she's possessed of tremendous sexual agency, which of kind of sexual, in, you know, her sexuality is profoundly individuated, as we will discover when you get to the very last chapter. You know, it's not just a male idea of a woman's sexuality. It is an attempt to really represent that sexuality.
And all complicated, yeah, and deep, yeah. yeah.
And
yeah.
you know, and clearly, she loves Bloom. Bloom loves her. Like, you know, they're for all of the things that are wrong between them. Joyce doesn't demonize this,
right?
Her from this, and he doesn't punish her for that,
right?
I think when you look back at the 19th century novel and you look at you know, Anna Karenina being unfaithful and, you know, jumping on the railroad tracks, and Emma Bovary being unfaithful and drinking arsenic, you know, adulteresses, Hester Prynne, you know, whatever.
Sure.
Also, in the kind of long history of the 19th century novel, an adulteress tended to be punished in ways that an adulterer was not. So if you were to ask me, I would say that's pretty goddamn feminist, you know, willingness to give her all that room.
Her character, the way, you know, the way he draws her and all the other characters, is always without judgment. It's always without idealization. And I think that's really refreshing.
Yeah, it's incredible.
In what ways do you think Joyce brings together tradition and also modernity?
The real answer to that question is like as long as the book itself, right? Just because I think this is the actual project. Like, it is to take modern Ireland or Dublin in 1904 in like mm-hmm. all of its urban turn of the century complexity and give it mythic scale and proportion. That's mm-hmm. the whole project, right? Mm-hmm. But the short answer is, you know, aside from the Odyssey and the kind of Homeric parallels, Joyce, the story also finds a lot of parallel with Hamlet, which is a primary text for it, right? Mm-hmm. At one point, Stephen lectures gives a lecture on Shakespeare at the National Library and, you know, kind of offers this kind of very convoluted theory about how Hamlet is obviously is also his own father's ghost, right? Mm-hmm. You know, and that ties back to Joyce to Bloom's own lost child in the story, and you know, all of that, right? And also, you know, and besides Shakespeare, the book alludes to, you know, Irish history, on which I'm No expert. Anglo-Irish mythic tradition in history, Semitic history. You know, the book is tuned to both actual tradition and actual history, literal, you know, events, and mythic tradition, which are the traditions of Greek mythology and Shakespeare.
Sure.
And, you know, I think the whole book is really just like the straining of daily, the most mundane daily experience you can imagine, through this prism of history and mythology.
And
I think that's where the book kind of gains its lasting resonance. I mean, you know, what Zadie Smith said about the book is correct, you know.
Yeah,
really, right? It represents something that has never been represented this way.
A really thrilling intermingling.
Yeah.
To one of the points you made a moment ago, the novel also does explore Israel and Jewishness in Ireland. It deals with the anti-Semitism of the Irish people, who themselves are persecuted by the English. It is a vicious cycle, maybe we could say, of the bullied suddenly doing the bullying. How does Joyce handle all this?
Yeah, well, it's a good, so really, you know, it's worth kind of remembering that he wrote the book, you know, at a time when English anti-Semitism was, you know, was and European anti-Semitism was rising and rising and rising. And, you know, and Eliot, you know, a famous anti-Semite, the fact that that was one of the book's primary champions is sort of an illustration of the problem. Yes. But I think Joyce, you know, while he was writing the book and before he was writing the book, he lived in Trieste for a while. Mm-hmm. And that's really where he began kind of developing his, you know, developing the novel. And while he was there, he was working as a tutor, and a lot of his students were European Jews. And I think he saw the parallel immediately. You know, that while he was there, I think he understood, you know, that the plight of the Irish, or the predicament of the Irish in Ireland and in relation to England, was very like the things that he had, that he saw, you know, in the Austro-Hungarian Jews that he encountered in Trieste. So that's what he decided to do with Bloom. It is one of the most wonderful aspects of the novel, because not just in some sort of like abstract form of being, you know, of being, you know, combating anti-Semitism, but because Bloom himself is so his poise and his kind of his own patience and humanity in the face of all these people who are just shitting on him behind his back and saying all this, you know, anti-Semitic stuff all the time, every time he turns around. And it's kind of the way that Joyce constructs the character is one of the most kind of like beautiful and relatable and lovable things about Bloom and about the novel.
Oh yeah. I mean, a real sense of dignity and resilience.
Yeah. Yeah.
I want to shift gears a bit. The book was banned, obviously, so much has been made of it, initially in many parts of the world for being obscene. Joyce writes frankly, he calls it a frank discourse, about masturbation, sex, defecation, urination, sadomasochism, genitalia, and fetishism. What was the reaction to the novel, it being one of the first of its kind to go to such explicit places? Also, why do you think Joyce sought to push the envelope in this way?
Yeah, well, first of all, the reaction of the novel was just what you'd kind of expect at that particular hinge of human history, which is that, you know, it was banned in places. It was banned in the States. It was excerpts were published in a magazine called The Little Review.
Yes.
And, you know, those were impounded, and copies of the book were also, you know, when the book itself came along, there was an obscenity trial around the book. Mm-hmm. But the reason he did it, I mean, first of all, I guess it's worth mentioning that Joyce himself was an unabashed pervert. There's no real way to get around that. If you've ever read his love letters to his wife, they're really quite astonishing. Because they're so, you know, they're not just filthy, and they are at times kind of hilarious. But I would also say that, you know, he has definite tastes, and some of those tastes are not entirely mainstream. He had a thing about scat. He had a thing about pissing. It's quite humanizing to read your favorite literary genius address his wife as "my darling brown arsed fuckbird."
Oh my gosh!
But when you ask why did he do it, I mean, I think he decided to push the envelope in this way because he knew that if you were going to represent life, he had to go all the way. I mean, you know, really, this was the whole project, right?
Yes, yes.
You know, this is what we talk about when we talk about the book, putting things in that most people leave out, right? And most novels leave out.
Even right? today, even yeah. by today's standards. Yes. Yeah.
Novels do not tend to spend like 3 or 4 pages on the John, like Leopold does in his outhouse. And it's like, you know, this is, and I think, you know, he was doing it because no one else was doing it. Mm-hmm. And I think there was, you know, something of modernism in this, right? I mean, modernism meant God was no longer watching. So, you know, so the
I got it. Yeah.
unleashed. And, you know, and it was, and when it was banned, it was also banned in England. You know, it wasn't just Eliot, you know, Yeats and Pound, another anti-Semite and worse, you know, were the people who championed it. Right. Mm-hmm. And it was in about 10 years later, around 1934, it was unbanned in the States. But I would say, you know, before Joyce, obviously there were books that were a little scandalous, Lawrence and the Rainbow, you know, D.H. Lawrence and the Rainbow. There were books that had been charged with being obscene. But I think Joyce took it a lot further. But with all of that said, you know, it's definitely not obscene. I always think about that. There's a passage in Portrait of the Artist where Stephen talks about what he calls proper art, which seeks to inspire a feeling of aesthetic arrest, and pornographic art, which is meant to incite, you know, desire. And Ulysses, you know, leaving aside the kind of contemporary connotations of proper, I feel like, you know, he's right about that. I mean, Ulysses does nothing if not inspire aesthetic arrest. You know.
Yep. I agree. Yeah. To this point, some critics say that Joyce knew even more about psychology, especially desire, than Freud. An example might be Bloom's denial of Molly's adultery. He achieves much of this through stream of consciousness, as we said earlier. Talk to us a little bit about this technique and his usage of it. Everything you just said about obscenity and getting to the root of the human condition in an honest way, and how it relates to stream of consciousness, maybe.
Yeah. I think, you know, look, I'm not an expert on Freud either. It's been a while since I've read him, but I think the beauty and the kind of incredible poignancy of the novel comes from, you know, I alluded to this earlier, from you know, Bloom's predicament, which is that he knows what's happening. He knows Boylan is coming to the house to screw his wife at, you know, 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock. It's constantly on his mind. It's on his mind from the beginning. He's anxious about it. And, you know, and yet he's planned his entire day in a way in order to allow it to happen. Yes. Right. He's made sure that he's not going to be there. He keeps thinking about it and pushing it out of his mind. And, you know, and it's, you know, and I feel like that's what people do so much, right? It's like
deny.
And, you know, the very kind of ambivalent matter of what they want and what they get and what they fear are depicted in this book in such an incredible, I mean, just the pulse of Bloom's thoughts and the way that this event, which is, I think, you know, really the central event of the novel in a way, is just phenomenal. It's the most exacting representation of that I've ever seen by far. You know, and it's very, very, very human, and it, you know, opens up the question of, you know, does he secretly want it, even though he doesn't want it? And for reasons I'll come to later, I think he does want it, if not necessarily with Boylan. I think he probably has a little bit of a cuckold.
I was just going to say, maybe there's another fetish that we haven't touched there, which is cuckold.
Yeah, no, he definitely has one. We'll come back to why and how it expresses itself later. But, you know, there's also, you know, he has his own little secret thing on the side, which is much more innocuous, right? But he has rented a post office box under the name Henry Flower, where he's kind of wheedling with a woman who's referred to as Martha Clifford. You know, that may be a pen name, just like Henry Flower is. You know, and it's very clear that they're never going to consummate this, but he's sort of, you know, he's asking for, you know, dirty pictures, and, you know, can you send me a little something something? And she's like, well, maybe, you know, maybe you could send me a few, you know, a few pounds, a few guineas, whatever. You know, and which provides a kind of countercurrent for him, right? So it's like there is a way in which both of these people have erotic lives that are half concealed from one another.
staying with this thread, Joyce's wife, Nora, said that Joyce knew nothing about women, but Jung, the famous psychologist, thought that he initially panned the book, eventually came to praise Joyce's insights into female psychology. How does Joyce write about women and more largely gender, as there are also feminine aspects to the masculine that he examines?
Yeah, for sure. I would say two things about that. One, how much James Joyce knew about women is up for debate. How much do any of us who are not women know about women, right?
Absolutely.
I would assume that from Nora's perspective, I'm sure Nora was right that there was a ton that Joyce didn't know about women. Yeah. But Joyce the artist, I think Joyce the artist in the context of the book, as we just described, certainly seems to understand Molly and depict her quite persuasively and quite well. Mm-hmm. But I do think too that the feminine, you mentioned the feminine aspects of the masculine, and it's not an accident that, you know, that Bloom's name is Bloom and that his pseudonym is Flower. I mean, these are these are kind of archetypal feminine ideas, and particularly in his kind of late in the book, when he and Stephen finally meet and they have their kind of, you know, protracted encounter, you know, Bloom is a nurturer in that situation. And, you know, and for Stephen, who is, you know, estranged from his family and from the church, he doesn't, you know, he's someone his mother is dead. He's in mourning for his mother. He's wearing black, which is, you know, another kind of salient fact about the book, but he's away from his family and I think needs both father and mother. And I think Bloom in some sense is both.
Yeah. They do kind of serve each other, as these sort of representations for mother, a father, child, son. Today is Bloomsday, of course, June 16th. Joyce had a great affinity for his city, Dublin. In turn, the city celebrates him and his novel every year on this date. The day, though, in 1904, when Ulysses takes place, tell us about how, first of all, Bloomsday is celebrated in Dublin. Also, why did Joyce set his story in 1904, 18 years before the year of publication?
Yeah, I'll answer these questions the second half of it first.
Sure.
He set the book on that date for a reason that is incredibly prosaic, which is that happens to be the date where Joyce, the man, went on his first date with Nora. They took a walk. I think they kind of fooled around at the end. I believe it ended it with like a hand job. you know, they got sexual. They got to it right away. So that day was, you know, he wanted to mark that day. But having said that, you know, when that happened, he was 22, and I'm guessing he was very much like, or at least, you know, to some degree, like Stephen Dedalus, which is to say, young, full of ambition, full of artistic plans, full of learning, you know, planning to just go out and you know, his whole, you know, all future was mapped out as I'm going to change literature. and Nora, wasn't any of these things, right? She was a waitress, and yet when they met, for whatever reason, and you know, again, I certainly think that I say for whatever reason, I think for the reason that people can do this with or without education, she really understood him. He felt understood. He felt that she saw him and was right for him. And I think out of that, you know, Ulysses, and I would suspect some of the contrast between Stephen, who we haven't talked about much yet, but who's kind of pedantic and highfalutin and a much harder character to love. Bloom is, he's necessary, but I think, you know, Bloom is a character we can love. Stephen is a character we can admire some of their insights and their ambitions, but he's a much harder character to kind of glom onto and to know.
I think that's fair. Yeah.
Right. I think that, you know, that was Joyce. And I think the kind of more kind of earthbound, you know, sort of low bourgeois Blooms were probably a way for him to kind of introject some of Nora into the book, you know, and build that out. anyway, he started working on Ulysses in the teens, so the date wasn't like he was reaching 20 years back.
Sure.
Right? More like 10.
Right. Yeah, and it started getting serialized in 1918, I think, right? Years before that.
But the date has, as for how Bloomsday is celebrated, it's gone on to take on the significance of a major cultural holiday. I've actually not yet gone to Ireland at all, but I gather it sort of began in the 1950s with a handful of writers just saying, like, we're gonna pay homage to this book by retracing Bloom's steps in the novel, because one of the fascinating things about the book is that it is still possible to do this. The book is so specific in where everything is that you really can, there are maps and you can, they exist online and in the guidebooks. It is possible to like walk the exact path that Bloom or Stephen take over the course of the day, and to see all these places in order. But I think it began with a bunch of writers who were just like, we're going to celebrate this amazing book by basically following Bloom's steps as a kind of pub crawl. And I gather they didn't make it all the way. They were just way too hammered by the time they got halfway through it. But now it's a thing that spans like 2 weeks, right? And it's parades and costumes. I mean, I think it's almost more like something like Pride, if you happen to look at it.
Wow. Yeah.
And it is like, it's
as writers, this isn't, tremendously encouraging that a single fiction writer can have such a cultural impact on his homeland.
Yeah.
So Ulysses offers a density, we could say, moment to moment details that captures the phenomenology of a person, of being alive. Stream of consciousness does this. One minute we're experiencing personal memory and then filtered cultural history and then the immediacy of a situation and then the large context of the society and all these sensations all at once. How does Joyce do it, that is, stream of consciousness differently from Wolfe or Proust, who were also those types of writers?
Well, Proust was never as fragmented as Joyce. Mm. He just wasn't. His sentences are baroque. They're long, they're scrolling, they're filled with subordinate clauses, but his representation of consciousness is polished and continuous. It's a kind of scroll, and it's amazing. I mean, if you ever want to come back and talk about that one.
In Search of Lost Time, sure.
Yeah. You'd have to give some time to reread it because it has been a few years. But, and I think, Wolfe too, even though there are times, I'm thinking of The Waves, which, kind of strobes its way through the consciousness of six people, I think. It's been a while.
Six, yeah.
But, so it does have a kind of bitted up fragmentary quality, but it's not anywhere near as kind of spontaneous and flowing and punning. I think Joyce really is kind of trying to represent in language the sort of chaotic associative tumble of thought sometimes. Mm. That he ramps it up in places in the novel and peels it back a little in others. But he besides from the punning, there's the portmanteau words where he'll kind of take two words and jam them together to make one new word out of them. Wolfe and Proust don't do that. So I think that the difference is really just down to Joyce's linguistic invention and his register, which is very different. And I would say, here and there can start to feel, it's like, because you don't have stops and you don't have periods and you don't have, it's kind of just this gushing torrent of, and there are any number of writers who have picked that up or kind of, picked some of that up from him since then.
Sure.
There are times when you just think, man, I wish you could just give me a paragraph break or someplace I could just
catch your breath.
But much of the time it's quite legible and quite wonderful. Yeah.
I agree. Joyce had said that he wanted to integrate as many puzzles and enigmas as possible to keep the scholars guessing and discussing for centuries and thereby ensure his immortality. What are some of those puzzles or enigmas that he littered the book with?
Yeah, look,
there's so many.
All day question. One thing that I just resist on principle is reading the book as a treasure hunt, right? I mean, I keep circling back to this because it's so important. It's like, it is a treasure hunt in the sense that all novels are treasure hunts. But if you spent all the time looking for Joyce's Easter eggs, you'll miss the bunny, so to speak. Yeah. Right? You'll miss the real event. But with that said, there are like a million of them, right? And many of them are to do with actual Dublin people and Dublin history. But some of them that crop up are just weirder and humbler than that. There's an anonymous postcard that turns up in the novel. I can't remember if Bloom receives it or if someone else does, but the postcard just reads U.P. up. And the meaning of this postcard is something that scholars haggle over. Like, what does it say? What does that mean? U.P. up. There's a man wearing a Macintosh, or maybe named Macintosh, or named, you know, M apostrophe Intosh, who kind of shows up. He shows up at Patty Dignam's funeral. He's kind of, you see him, he's seen multiple times in the background of the novel, and no one knows. It's sort of, scholars will worry about, well, who is that? Martha Clifford, who is Joyce's pen pal? Is this someone who's Bloom's pen pal? Sorry. You know, is this someone who has a, you know, another incarnation in the book, just as Bloom is, you know, just as Henry Flower is Bloom, or is it just a person who doesn't exist in any other capacity in the novel?
I always admire that a lot from, you know, writers or filmmakers, any kind of artist who can create a lot of questions without providing answers, or who like to sort of deal in ambiguity. I think that that's what does make a lot of work sort of timeless.
Yeah, they're fun. And I would also say,
yeah,
they do offer the pleasures of just recognition in the reader. In the, you know, the book is full of also these kind of, you know, the clock of the book is amazing. Just in the way that, you know, you'll have a scene in which Stephen hears a thunderclap at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and then page, you know, hundreds of pages later, Molly will allude to, you know, being startled out of her nap by a thunderclap, and you're like, oh, that, you know, or you know, Bloom spots a kind of torn up flyer that's kind of floating down the Liffey, and then much later in the novel, someone else sees the same flyer after it has floated like far downstream. Mm-hmm. There are all these kind of strands of matter and you know, and moments in time that are recurrent. What places where the novel keeps crossing its own path, and I think that's another, you know, pleasure for the reader is to kind of find those things, and recognize them for what they are.
Yeah, always very rewarding. Yeah. We can't talk about Ulysses without talking about Sylvia Beach. So the publication history of Ulysses, as we said, began in 1918 when it was serialized in the Little Review. Then Sylvia Beach published the whole text through her Shakespeare and Company publishing house in 1922. It was considered a big gamble, right, for her. Why? Why was it such a gamble?
Well, Sylvia Beach, the pastor's daughter from Pennsylvania, I think she was. As you know, the book was already being serialized by an American magazine, by the Little Review, and it was already undergoing legal challenges in the States. So it's not like she didn't know what she was getting into, right?
Sure,
she knew
sure.
She was publishing something that was going to be challenged in America and in England as being obscene. And she just knew Joyce from his coming into Shakespeare and Company. She knew him as someone who came into the store, and she had admired his earlier work. She found him very congenial. She liked him personally, found him easy to talk to. But she didn't have any publishing experience. She was not someone who had already published books. So she may have been a little naive to, you know, even though she surely must have known what was happening with the excerpts of the book abroad, she surely knew that, you know, she may have also just gone, well, you know, what could happen? I've never published a book before. But really, I think she did it because she thought it was going to make her famous. She believed in the book. And she thought, you know, this book is a masterpiece. It's going to be acknowledged as a masterpiece, and if I am the person who publishes it, it's going to be good for my fortune and for my store, and you know, for my, you know, it'll be good for all parties concerned.
Sure.
I'm not sure it did. You know, I know she borrowed money to publish it, right? It cost her money she didn't have, And she didn't make that money back, I think, because when it was reprinted by Random House and by other publishers 10 years later, Joyce kind of left her in the lurch.
Mm.
So, yeah.
Episode, we should say also, for those who don't know, the the title, the book is not broken into chapters as much as they are broken into episodes. And episode 18 has been written about extensively, Oxen of the Sun. And it's often written about for a few reasons. It's where Bloom and Daedalus finally meet. It is where Bloom reflects on the death of his son, his infant son. It's where Joyce recapitulates the whole of the English language in a long and challenging stream of wordplay. It's also structured to mirror the 9-month gestation of a fetus in a womb. He does so many things in just one episode.
Yes.
Say a little bit more about this section and its significance to literary history.
Oxen of the Sun is where many readers of Ulysses crap out, if not spirit. it's where the language is the most kaleidoscopic and difficult. You know, it changes from paragraph to paragraph. As you say, moving through the kind of gestational stages of the English language, right? It starts with sort of pagan incantations and goes to Middle England and English, and then parodies Milton and parodies Swift and parodies Dickens, and it comes all the way to the, you know, parodies contemporary advertising language, parodies kind of vulgar non-literary language as well. You know, he claims to have spent 1,000 hours writing it. He is totally showing off. Yep. And it's a, you know, it's not super fun. but having said that, you know, and I also think it's kind of cruel that he follows this section with Ulysses, which is 150 pages of language that is nowhere near as dense, right? Those pages are written all like a play. So there's,
exactly.
On the page, but it's also, incredibly hallucinatory. It's where the book gets radically fantastical, although it's also very funny, which is good, which helps it. But it's those two episodes are the most difficult core of the novel, and it's a place where you sometimes have to struggle a little. In fact, maybe struggle quite more than a little, to just kind of follow the basic action. Guides help because that action isn't itself so difficult. It's the difficulties in the language that sometimes can seem like it obscures it a little bit. I think I mentioned earlier that I read it with all the kind of good, you know, kind of literary guides to Ulysses that are in print, which they still are, in a more kind of casual way. There's a fairly useful website called ulyssesguide.com, which is nowhere near as granular, but actually does a pretty good job of explaining the kind of core of the novel and giving you some of the, you know, giving you a kind of handrail for what Joyce is doing. So, you know, I think the last time I read it, a year and a half ago, I was like, yeah, here and there, I would just hop onto that website and just be like, you know, read a little so that I could, if I found myself at sea, I could remind myself where I was.
That's great. Thank you for that. And that's in the comment section as well. So there's a great long sequence towards the end of the novel in which Joyce discusses the parallel courses taken by Bloom and Daedalus during the end of their day and their return home. They converge and diverge on several subjects. How would you characterize their friendship? We wait for hundreds of pages for them to finally meet and be together for a bit. And then they depart after being together and having this long conversation. If you had to summarize the quality of that relationship.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's very interesting. Friendship, in a way, I don't even know that friendship is the first word I'd use. I mean, it is one, or it becomes one. But Bloom, you know, initially when they encounter each other, Bloom knows Simon Daedalus. He knows Stephen's father. And as you mentioned at the beginning, in the scheme of the novel, right, Bloom is Odysseus and Stephen is Telemachus. Like they are in kind of mythopoetic terms, father and son. Stephen and his actual father are estranged. And Bloom sort of steps in as a surrogate parent, but it is coded. You know, he first sees Stephen and his drunken buddies at the maternity ward in the previous chapter. And I meant to say, too, just about Oxen of the Sun, that, the reason it is structured that way is that Oxen of the Sun in the Odyssey is the episode where Odysseus and his men are shipwrecked on an island and they're warned not to slaughter the cattle. Because they're the oxen, because they're the sacred symbols of fertility. Helios is oxen, and of course they do, and that fucks them up. And so the kind of fertility, theme of that episode in the Odyssey is why Oxen of the Sun is set in a maternity ward, and why there are 40 paragraphs in it, one for each week of a woman's pregnancy. I mean, you know, it's right. Kind of worked out at that level.
Very thoughtfully done.
Yeah, quite. But anyway, so when Bloom sees Stephen and his drunken buddies in the hospital in Oxen of the Sun, he's like, oh, that's Simon's boy. And he's worried about how drunk Stephen is, right? He's like, you know, boy, I better make sure that boy gets, you know, makes it home. So he follows Stephen into Nighttown in the next section to Circe to look after him. And that section is the one that just goes completely batshit with hallucination for both of them. I mean, it's really pretty close to an LSD trip in literary form.
It's like Hunter S. Thompson or something. Yeah.
It's really crazy. And then at the end of that section, he walks him to a cab stand. And then finally is like, why don't you come over and have a cup of tea? I'll make you a cup of tea. You know, I'll sober you up, son. And that's, you know, that's the sort of first essence of their relationship. Bloom is just Stephen's fatherly protector. He's courteous. He's humane. He's thoughtful. He's kind. He's all the things that he is throughout the novel. It's really another place where we can really attach to Bloom as just a kind of beautiful man. Mm. But Stephen, on the other hand, it's much harder to parse what Stephen's feelings about Bloom, such as they are, might be. The scene when they're in the kitchen having tea, we have access to Bloom's thoughts, but we have no access to Stephen's. So, you know, in that way, it's like Stephen remains
opaque.
Efficient. Yeah. We just don't know.
I just want to tell our viewers, if you have any questions for Matthew, please start sending them in. We'll get to them shortly. I have another two questions myself to get through.
Yeah.
The final episode, Penelope, is famous for its punctuationless 40-page or so Molly Bloom stream of consciousness, in which she reflects while in bed beside Leopold, on her marriage to him, her childhood, her admirers, the man she had the affair with, Gibraltar, her girlhood lesbian encounter, the events of the day, and Bloom's proposal, among many other things, and all punctuated towards the end by the refrain, yes. And there's also a sense of emotional complexity too, joy, sensuality, ecstasy, anger, pity, relief, gratitude. If you could, in the time we have, please try to dissect the final section for us and tell us, what does it do that is so significant?
Well, a couple things. First of all, there's one aspect of Bloom's relationship with Stephen that I have not yet touched upon, which is when he goes upstairs to, you know, get ready for bed, but, you know, prior to the Molly section or in the Molly section, he suggests that this nice young man would make a wonderful Italian teacher for his wife. He wants Stephen to tutor his wife in Italian. What he really wants is for Stephen to displace Boylan. He wants Boylan, you know, Boylan, who's just a pig and a loudmouth and an asshole. Mm-hmm. He thinks, I would much rather be cuckolded by this thoughtful and intelligent young man who could offer my wife something that I can't. Mm-hmm. Which is really kind of and in the course of Molly's thoughts, as she, you know, as Stephen crosses her mind later in this chapter, it becomes clear that from her perspective will probably happen. You know, she doesn't, this idea hasn't been proposed to her, but it's something. As for the episode itself, you know, with Molly, it's not entirely punctuation free, right? It's eight sentences and there's no punctuation, but there are paragraph breaks. So there are kind of like ledges where you can rest. And it's beautiful. It really is, because it's the place where we see everything that's been held in check. All of Bloom's anxiety about being cuckolded, all of his despair and his loneliness that we've been privy to throughout the novel, gets flipped over.
Yeah.
And we see him, a mixed picture of him, to be sure, but we see him and we see everything that's happened that he's been kind of denying. Through her eyes. You know, to be sure, some of what we see is kind of Bloom's nightmare. You know, there's a lot of stuff in there about Boylan's virility and his, you know, his size. And she, though, although she does, as I'll come to, kind of turn away from Boylan in the end, but she's, you know, she does love, that is also becomes clear over the course of the section. So, you know, on the one hand, yeah, the run-on qualities of the sentences and the way that one kind of subject runs into another, because we really are just in Maui's kind of edge of sleep kind of thought. Mm-hmm. It's challenging, but on the other hand, it's like the most welcoming, beautiful part of the novel. And she spends those pages thinking about Bloom and thinking about Boylan, but also wandering through her entire sexual history.
Yeah.
She knew before Bloom and after. About her affair with a man named Bartell Darcy, whose character who appears in Dubliners. He's important in the story The Dead. She thinks about her childhood in Gibraltar, because her father was a major in the army. Her own first sexual experience. A lot has been made of the book's kind of erotic, and this section in particular is erotic properties. And even though 100 years later, we've all got much filthier stuff on our phones, I'm sure all of us.
Yeah.
It ain't, you know, it's forthright in ways even Lawrence didn't come close to.
Yeah, and he was pretty forthright.
Yeah.
But yeah, so it says a lot. Yeah. I think it's hopeful. I think the book ends on a hopeful note.
It absolutely ends on a hopeful note. Because as she, you know, I mean, one thing, and I forget if we mentioned this before, is Bloom and Molly haven't had sex since their infant son died, which is part of the problem, right? Bloom is kind of locked out of his own castle. I do think that by the time she gets to the, you know, and there are many ways to read it. I think you can read the soliloquy and come to different conclusions about how Molly really regards her husband, because there's both a kind of patience and impatience.
Yes.
Right.
Which is honest and real. And I think that's, you know, everybody's experience of their partner.
But I do think that the kind of yes, I will, yes, that really is him. That really is directed at Bloom. That's her remembering how he proposed to her, you know, comes back to their kind of the earliest days of their time together. And, you know, and I view that as a very affirmative thing.
Yes. Affirming the commitment. Okay, a bunch of questions came in. Can you please comment on the recent rash of book bans on school and public libraries in the USA? And this is very relevant, obviously.
To
Ulysses.
I can comment on them that they're, you know, obviously completely fucked. that they, you know, not to put too fine a point on it, that they speak to, you know, strains of American Puritanism that have been a real problem in this country since its inception. They recur and they recur and they recur, and it's, you know, so it's like, it's not the first time, you know, that obscenity bans in the, you know, the 20s and 30s, you know, it is so embedded in what's wrong with us.
Hypocritical.
Hypocritical, and, yeah. You know, and I think, you know, so, you know, yeah, if Ulysses were a contemporary novel, or if anybody were, if it were a book that people were, you know, that young people were considered capable of reading, I'm sure they'd get around to rebanning it too.
Kind of makes me want to do a graphic novel adaptation. Is there one yet in existence?
I don't think so. It would be amazing.
Yeah, let's get on that. Do you have any comments on Joyce's Finnegan's Wake?
I've never read Finnegan's Wake. Okay. I don't know anyone who has. Right before she died, and then I've injected a little comment on Finnegan's Wake in the book I'm writing on now, but I really don't. I think that it is by most. Have you read Finnegan's Wake?
I've not.
I don't. No. I mean, I don't. I can't say that I knowingly know anybody who has read Finnegan's Wake, and you know, it's just where Joyce gave the you know, the kind of linguistic inventiveness. He just went full bore with that book, and wrote it in a dialect that is, you know, a kind of funhouse version of English. I haven't had the desire to read it, to be honest. It just seems like a place where the you know, adventures in the language and the legibility and you know, approachability of the reading experience would probably defeat me pretty quick. Mm-hmm. But you know, one thing I will say is that it is, I do think it is slightly, there are ways in which it is prefigured in this. The final chapter, the Maui chapter, is something that Joyce said, you know, really has no beginning or end. It has this kind of riverine quality, this idea that it's supposed to be, you know, like the Liffey, or, you know, that it's meant to kind of, you know, flow to the sea, so to speak. And Finnegan's Wake, in a way, just takes that conceit and renders it larger, right? I mean, the thing that I think everybody knows about Finnegan's Wake, one of the only things, is that it runs in a circle, that it ends in the middle of a sentence and begins in the middle of that same sentence, so that when you get to the end, to complete the sentence, you have to go back to the beginning. It goes around in a circle. Mm. I'm sorry, I can't be more.
No, that's great. That's very, very honest and still very insightful. So reading Ulysses for the first time, just starting on Oxen of the Sun, I know there's debate on whether or not Ulysses is a Catholic or anti-Catholic novel. What are your thoughts?
I think that it is a, I'm gonna split hairs. I think it is a Catholic novel that is opposed to the Catholic Church. You know, Joyce left the Catholic Church, as we know. You know, same thing for Stephen. You know, for Stephen, it's a kind of a rupture with his family. It's a rupture with his history. I don't know to what extent that was true for Joyce himself, but I know that, you know, that at the same time, this book is very, very, very steeped in theology and in Thomas Aquinas. And, it, you know, I do think of it as a religious novel. I do think of it as a sacred novel. You know, the book literally opens with, you know, Buck Mulligan carrying his shaving mirror and razor in a cross, and saying in Latin, I will go now to the altar of God. And the fact that he's using, you know, profane or kind of mundane, ordinary, non-religious symbols in a religious context, I mean, that is profane, and that is, you know, in a sense, something that the church probably wouldn't have loved. But it is also meant, I think, with a certain kind of sincerity. That is what he is doing with this, you know, that's a kind of declaration of what Joyce is going to do with this novel. Yes. You know, and I think of him as someone who didn't, you know, who ultimately found that the sacred and the profane weren't separable.
Right.
That they were consonant with one another.
Yeah. I mean, you know, the interplay between the sacred and the profane in the book is tireless. You know, it's like one minute he's talking about like defecation or urination or masturbation, and the next minute he's talking about like Irish history or the Roman Catholic Church. I guess my final question for you is, if you had to summarize the overriding or prevailing universal theme of Ulysses, what would you say it is? Or could
As be? I would say, look, you know, what Joyce was trying to say with Ulysses was the book itself. But I would say, you know, we are all wanderers like Bloom. I mean, he chose the Odyssey, he chose the Hamlet, he chose the kind of shaping text for this novel for a reason. You know, we are all wanderers like Bloom. We're all kind of outsiders like Bloom. You know, in Stephen's kind of rupture with the church, there's a kind of alienation in that character that I think remains very modern and very true. I think we're all kind of still in that position too, somewhat, right? You know, maybe more so, you know, than people were at the dawn of the First World War, you know? So you know, I think by kind of choosing these epics of, you know, both an epic of homecoming and, you know, and in Hamlet, the kind of the ultimate, you know, grapple with mortality, that he's kind of uniting the two of the most profound stories in the history of human civilization. You know.
Well, that's great. Thank you for that, Matthew. The book, obviously, of course, is Ulysses by James Joyce. Do you have your copy handy?
I do. I have two copies. I have this one, which is the kind of standard hardback.
Yeah.
I also splurged on this kind of amazing.
Oh, beautiful. That's a beautiful cover. That's gorgeous. Yeah,
it's really quite wild. It's got kind of like paintings and, you know, kind of.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Yeah, it's wonderful.
Who's
the
publisher?
Publisher in this case is Other.
Okay, I'm going to have
to. It's only a year or two old. Yeah, it's a Spanish painter, Eduardo Arroyo, 1937 to 2018, had a dream of illustrating Ulysses, and he started working on the project in 89. So it's finally was published a couple of years ago, and I thought that would be a nice thing to have.
It's the precursor to our forthcoming graphic novel adaptation of Ulysses. to learn more about Ulysses and James Joyce, as Matthew said, please visit ulyssesguide.com, and that link is in the comments section. Thank you, everybody, so much for joining, and have a great and safe weekend. Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks, Matthew. Bye. Take care, everyone. Bye-bye. Yeah.